I'm with Georgia Athletic Director Greg McGarity here in his office in Athens, the Buttsmere Heritage Hall. First of all, thank you so much for spending time with us. Really appreciate it.
My pleasure. It's great to have you guys here.
Well, it's great to be here. You know, summertime on a college campus is a little interesting, a little different than normal. Mm-hmm. What is life like kind of now that the athletic calendar is over and football looming? What's life like for you these days?
Well, we're trying to wrap up our fiscal year, which ends June 30th. And then we'll open the books on the new budget, which this year is approaching $154 million. We'll start July 1. So it's almost like Christmas time for our business office because they're trying to get all the expenses in, everything that we can calculate to go ahead and end the fiscal year. But really it's a time for preparation for us, getting ready for the football season, volleyball, soccer. They obviously start in this fall. So it's a lot of time for our staff to take a break too, because when these young people come back really July 8th, for the second session of summer school, we have almost virtually all our student athletes back. So while we're not competing, everybody's preparing for the 2020 academic year. So a lot of activity, a lot of summer school, a lot of off-season conditioning. So it'll be really, really busy picking up July 8th.
It's interesting to hear you say that because obviously you work in sports, which is an aspiration for so many people, and yet it's a lot about budgets and fundraising and business and things like that. On most days sitting in this office doing what you do, does it feel like sports or does it feel like really any other kind of big business?
Well, not this time of year because, like you mentioned, there's no competition going on. So our efforts are primarily focused on fundraising and trying to get ahead of the game as far as planning for facilities, going ahead and getting them ready, making sure they're ready for practices and things of that nature. So we've got several projects ongoing right now that we're trying to make sure they're in place for this academic year. But a lot of it's just planning, preparation to make sure that really when you have a lot of people on campus and you're into the game management aspect of it, you've done a lot of the heavy lifting in June and July.
I want to talk to you about some of the issues that are going on with the program right now. And as you might imagine, I hear from a lot of Georgia fans about the Georgia-Florida rivalry in Jacksonville, where they want that to be. You obviously hear from a lot more than I do. If you had to guess, what is the balance of opinion right now in terms of staying in Jacksonville and going somewhere else, or at home and home?
Well, it's usually, I think any decision of that nature is going to be 50-50 or 60-40 one way or another. There's been feedback from a lot of people on why the game should move, why the game should stay in Jacksonville. You know, it's been there since 1933, and I know Kirby's been very vocal about the importance in recruiting, and that's certainly an important element of it, but there are a lot of other elements that go into the decision. So we're waiting to have further discussions with the city of Jacksonville to where we can receive maybe more updated information on what we may be looking at down the road. What will we receive? We'll evaluate it, but you know, when we do receive that, we'll huddle with our peers at the University of Florida. We'll huddle internally with Kirby and the president and maybe some other staff members to really give it a deep dive into what's best for the University of Georgia. And I'm sure Georgia and Florida will be on the same page. We usually are on a lot of issues, but there's a lot of work to be done. But again, we're in Jacksonville through 2021, so it's not something that has to be done right this second.
You mentioned Kirby's feelings about recruiting and wanting to host recruits in Athens. Most people take that to mean that Coach Smart would like to move this game out of Jacksonville. Is that a fair characterization of his opinion?
I think that's pretty much where Kirby stands because, you know, he's, you know him better than anybody. He is just a recruiting guru. So anytime something's done to take away from that effort, I think it feels like it affects our program. But there's so many other things going on in that game with that weekend that, you know, you've got to look at every aspect of it because a lot of people from Macon South and Jacksonville, Orlando, Tampa, we've got a lot of fans in North Florida that really love that game. So there are a lot of things to consider, but we'll all get together and at the end of the day, whatever decision we make, it'll be our decision.
You mentioned the fact that you and Florida have kind of worked as partners on this. You would have the option, though, to end this unilaterally. You can't obviously violate the contract, but when it's time to move on, if that's what Georgia wants to do, you wouldn't require any cooperation from Florida to want to move on if that was the case, correct?
Well, I don't think that'll happen because we both think alike in this game, but who knows if it's their home game, who knows where they could take it. If it's our home game, I know we'd like it here. There's been some talk of Atlanta. I'm not really sure that has much legs. If you're not going to play it in Jacksonville, then the games need to be on campus.
And then one more thing on that subject before we move on. I have a theory that if you try to do the rotational thing, which some people have suggested, Athens, Gainesville, Jacksonville, that once you don't play in Jacksonville every year anymore, that kind of loses some of its juice too. That's just my theory, but does that make sense to you?
I think we both lived through it. I was at Florida when the games were on campus, I think 94, 95, and it was just a regular game. There was no jazz to it. I know they were lopsided games there, but it was like any other game. So I think the uniqueness of the game creates a dynamic there that's unmatched other than Texas, Oklahoma. Mm-hmm. But a lot of great things to it that go on other than the game. Mm-hmm. You know, all my buddies, they're down on the beach and they don't even go to the stadium. They just go down the beach to watch the game. So a lot of different people do a lot of different things. So we're all over the map in what people would like to do.
Another issue where there's a lot of internal debate among fans right now is the alcohol policy at Sanford Stadium. The SEC's kind of loosened the reins on sales in the common area. You guys have decided that you want to sell to kind of premium donors in the premium seating area. Is it fair to say that those who don't want alcohol sales in Sanford Stadium are more vocal than those that do? The intensity on the side of the refrain side?
Absolutely. I'd say it's at least 2-1 on those that like it as it is, and they're okay in these premium areas or where they're not general seating areas. They know in a lot of these premium areas, they're actually in seats. Mm-hmm. You know, if you're on a bench and, you know, the seats are 18 inches wide, it's kind of tight, it's not the best in the world, but I do feel like it's very vocal on those that are against it in the general seating areas. But there are a lot of things to play out. I know we mentioned we're going to conduct a review. Mm-hmm. We will have some experts come in. Mm-hmm. And if we were to do it, how would we do it? Mm-hmm. Because right now, all our concession stands are manned, like they are in college football, mm-hmm. by groups of youngsters
or volunteers.
So, you know, to be able to serve alcohol, you've got to do it in certain areas. They got to be certified, licensed. So there are a lot of things that go into it as far as the liability piece of it. You know, it's really not a revenue decision. I know people might disagree with that, but the number, I'm not sure it moves the needle for us to be able to say we're doing this because of revenue. That will not be part of the discussion at all, because probably at best you may generate some income. But it takes, you know, right now we have challenges in our concession stands enough, and we've gone to really a grab-and-go concept. Mm-hmm. We've done away with things it takes someone to prepare for. Mm-hmm. So really it's grab, you go, you pay for it, because we know people want to get through the lines in a hurry. But I don't think I'd be able to stack up a row of, you know, 8-ounce beers.
Sure.
Nobody likes a warm beer. So we think of the time it would take to do that, the number of locations we'd have to do it. And so we've got to analyze how long would it take. Mm-hmm. If you're the 10th person in line, might take a minute to pour a beer. Yeah. So we've got to analyze all that and find out where we could do it within the confines of the stadium.
When the announcement was made, the national media kind of paid attention to the line of demarcation, $100,000 donors, $250,000 be guaranteed. Do you regret it any time it kind of comes out that it seems that Georgia's showing extra preference to its highest dollar donors? From a perception standpoint, how do you react to that?
Well, I think it's such a small number. Mm-hmm. Right now in the McGill Club that will be the McGill Lounge, there are only 200 donors in there. I mean, we've got over 1,000 donors in the McGill Society. Mm-hmm. So it's only a fraction of individuals, but what we're is sort of a good problem to have. We have a lot of interest. A lot of people have really given large donations. We really can't move their seat location until somebody gives up their seat location. So what do we have as an alternative to that? And so this is an alternative that among that group would say, well, let's offer this opportunity here. But you can't see the game. You know, so it's going to be maybe on a rainy, wet day or a cold day, people may hang out in there. But it's pretty much like that in college sports and professional sports. Mm-hmm. They're just different groups that are able to enjoy certain things, but I don't think we're ready right now to go over to the general seating area.
It almost leads to a different discussion as well, and this is not a problem unique to UGA, but, you know, college football in general is becoming kind of an expensive proposition, especially for y'all, because you've been winning so much of the last couple of years. A lot of fans have been traveling. How much time, if any, is spent saying, what do we do for the rank and file fan, the non-McGill Society donor, maybe the person that can't even afford season tickets anymore? What's out there now for the fan kind of below that financial consideration?
Well, we want to make sure what we have functions properly. I think everybody's familiar with the south side of the stadium. There's really nowhere to expand the concourses. We'd have to knock out Field Street and probably go towards the chemistry building. That's probably not going to happen. So, you know, we need to make sure that, that concessions are functioning at a very at the highest rate possible. Mm-hmm. Restrooms, that we're adding as many as we can and making sure they're clean, things along those lines. But we also want to keep our prices stable. Mm-hmm. Right now we're at $75 for our premium games, $55, but our season tickets have not increased this year. And hopefully we don't have to increase in the future. Mm-hmm. That's always probably the most controversial thing you can do is raise ticket prices. Mm-hmm. But we've not had to do that because we've been very successful fundraising. So when you're able to generate the amount of money we are through the McGill Society, I'm not having to spend our operating expenses to pay for facilities mm-hmm. because the money that's coming in the McGill Society is 100% spent toward facilities. Mm-hmm. So we're able to do certain things for other programs, and we just need to make it the best it can possibly be. Can the aisles get wider? You know, and we'd love to do that, but you're going to lose seats.
Yeah.
So there are a lot of things. Could we put handrails in the lower level? Well, we're in a situation where we really don't want to lose any tickets. Mm-hmm. So we try to make sure, you know, winning is the main thing. It's mm-hmm. not the only thing.
Sure.
But we try to focus on traffic. We try to focus on if we were going to the game, what would be our pinch points and our concerns. Mm-hmm. You know, if you go to the restroom, we may, starting with some technology, try to channel people to some areas that aren't used because mm-hmm. we do have a lot of restrooms, but we tried to upgrade them, keep them clean. Mm-hmm. We have custodians at every area of the stadium. So we're not perfect, but what we try to do is make it the best it can possibly be and have a great experience on the video board, make sure that the pageantry on the stadium, on the field is at its best to where people can really enjoy the college atmosphere.
Auburn wanted some scheduling relief because asked to play at Georgia and Alabama every other year. The SEC did that. You guys seem to want to go along with that. But one question I get asked by a lot of fans is, what did Georgia get out of this? Did Georgia gain by going along with this agreement?
Well, I think once the schedules are announced, a lot of answers, a lot of questions will be answered. Mm-hmm. I would just say be careful what you wish for mm-hmm. in some situations because we know what the schedules look like.
Okay.
We've seen it. So some school may want to do X, Y, or Z. Mm-hmm. Well, there are a lot of unintended consequences mm-hmm. with that because mm-hmm. it's not to where one school has an advantage. Mm-hmm. Every schedule we have, future schedule, is vetted by Kirby and Josh Lee. Mm-hmm. They chop it up. If we have problems with that, we get back to the SEC office and are able to give our opinion. Mm-hmm. And so far, we have not had any issues in that area. I think once it's announced that, I know there's some concern about tradition and the time, mm-hmm. The segment of time in there, mm-hmm. but if that game's at a different time for us
yeah.
and it works and Kirby's comfortable with it, you know, we're okay with it.
You mentioned Kirby being comfortable with it. At the beginning of spring practice, he did say that you can't judge a schedule until you see it in its totality. That seemed like less than a full endorsement of the decision for me, especially given the fact that, as I understand it, the trades with Tennessee, which is on the same home-road rotation, I expected him to be more in favor of it based on some of the things that had been said prior to those comments. Do you take that the same way that I do?
No, we have a schedule. Every school is able to comment on it. And if there's a really big, big problem, then the conference is able to work that out. And I would say in every instance, we've never had a situation there to where we are just so frustrated with. No one was happy with the Auburn back-to-back. Mm-hmm. But there were six schools involved in having to go back to back to a venue because when we added A&M and we added Missouri, certain things had to happen. So, you know, we're not able to really, I don't like to talk about publicly when we disagree with things, but that wasn't ideal. Mm-hmm. No one liked it, but mm-hmm. You're a member of a conference, there are 14 other members, and you're not going to get your way every time. Mm-hmm. So you have to basically be good partners in there. So I don't think we have any issues with any schedule.
One more thing on this subject. You know, the fan uses the phrase payback. Hey, you know, yeah. they would say right. Auburn owes Georgia right. something for then. Kirby Smart even referenced that last yeah. spring in Destin. Is it too simplistic to say that Auburn owes Georgia favor
yeah.
after that?
I think there would be, you know, three other schools that say, well, we need the same thing. Mm-hmm. But it's part of expansion. It was not easy on really a lot of people because a lot of things had to change. Traditional dates had to change. So back in that day when you add schools to the conference, and I'm sure if there are schools added in the future, they're going to be the same type issues there because it's very difficult to make schedules. It's very, very difficult to make 14 schools get everything that they want. But I'll say this, on our priorities, the conference listens to us and basically we've had a good run there.
couple more things before we wrap up. We certainly appreciate your time. You recently signed a one-year contract extension. Right. At the time, you said you wanted to be 1 year. Right. I know you've gone into some details on this in the past, but would you mind just speaking to a little bit about why it was your preference to have a one-year deal as opposed to a longer extension?
Yeah. I think something that I was very comfortable with, it's the same deal that the president has. So I've always felt like it should be a year-to-year deal here. Our goal is here, we'll sit down and evaluate it at the end of the, maybe in January, February, just see how things are going, everything. But it gives everybody total flexibility instead of signing a long-term deal and all of a sudden if you decide that, you know, it's time to move on, it's the best way to handle it. I think it's certainly the way I'm very comfortable with it, and the president is as well. So he and I are basically on the same grounds as far as our contracts.
Is it your expectation that you would be here through the end of the building of the football facility that so many people are so curious about?
You know, we don't know the timelines yet. You know, we're going through that right now. Matter of fact, I think that's one thing that even though there's no shovels in the ground, there is a tremendous amount of work almost every day on getting everything set the way that the football staff would like it, and you know this will have Kirby's fingerprints all over it. But I know he's excited about it. He wants it done tomorrow, but there are a lot of dynamics involved. But I'll say this: once it's completed, it's going to be certainly the best in the country.
One of the things that Georgia's gotten a lot of attention for the last few months is this, what I would call very aggressive non-conference scheduling philosophy. It's a lot of fun for fans. How much of this is Kirby kind of pushing for this on his own? How much of this is you guys working in concert with each other? You're obviously not going to reveal all the details of behind-the-scenes conversations, but I guess what is it like when y'all talk about scheduling philosophies and what has manifested itself in front of all of us?
Well, certainly there's some direction, some desires expressed by Kirby, and I have to give a lot of credit to Josh Lee, because what Josh Lee will do is call his counterparts at these schools, like at Oklahoma. Are you interested? At Texas, are you interested? And obviously, I know the respective ADs at those schools, so we'll talk at a certain level about once a lot of the heavy lifting is done. But Josh has done a splendid job in contacting these teams, and I'm all for it. But it's all about relationships, and it's all about your brand. So if you don't lock those games up now, they won't be available down the road. For instance, like Oklahoma's 2023 and 31. Well, the only way to get that game is to make that difference in the years work. And it's not perfect. We'd love to have Oklahoma here in 24, but the only way we could schedule the game, because they've already scheduled like we have in those years between 24 and 30. So we just want to get the games on the books. The big thing is it's a home and home. And so you've got FSU, you've got Texas, you know, and then we're going to Atlanta and playing Oregon and Virginia and Clemson, and then you got the Clemson. So a lot of things for people to look forward to down the road.
Dooley Field at Sanford Stadium is coming this year. That's exciting for a lot of fans, especially those like me who kind of grew up in the Dooley era. Some have also said it took too long to happen. From your perspective, did it take too long to honor Coach Dooley and former athletic director?
Gosh, that's, you know, it's just hard to say. I would say that you know, we're so excited about that happening. Matter of fact, I spoke to Coach Dooley earlier today on just some of the details, which we haven't got all the details worked out, but enough to where we know that we're going to have a very nice event on Friday night and then pregame around 3:30 or 3:40 on game day, because the game kicks at 4. We're going to have a very nice event in the stadium. But it's something we're all looking forward to, and it was really a fun day when the president and I went to 755 Millage Circle to talk to Coach Dooley about that opportunity.
Around the campus, a lot of other interesting things happening to sports programs. Men's basketball's probably never recruited better than it has now. It was an interesting season for the baseball, although I know Coach Strickland would have liked to see it end differently. Just kind of your overall perspective on some of the sports that maybe get less attention than football, kind of where you see those things right now.
Well, from a national competitive standard, we probably weren't where we've been in the past. I mean, I'm looking out my window now of two NCAA track championships. You know, the men finished in fourth place this year in the outdoor, and the women really struggled, but we had some individuals leave, turn professional. If you can imagine that, we have individuals turning professional in the sport of track. And we had an injury to one of our sprinters that's well documented there. But you know, Jeff Wallace had a phenomenal year, runner-up national champions. You know, as I was driving back from, coming back from Orlando, I said, gosh, you know, we were so close. So I went back and did some research and got with Claude, and I said, how many times have we finished second or runner-up in the country? And Claude and I were sitting there, and I said, you know, I started thinking about football once, tennis once, and we found out over the last, since 2011, we finished runner-up 16 times. So if half of those come true, or a third of them come true, you know, we would stack a lot more NCAA championships. So you can look at it both ways. It could have been a little bit better, could have been a lot better with a few more national championships, but I would say we did okay. I mean, there's tremendous room for growth here, but I know a lot of people are excited about, obviously, football, baseball, what Scott was able to do. And, you know, it's only the 13th time we've ever been to the NCAA championships in baseball. I mean, Lou Harris Tampa's taking us to softball 18 times in a row. So we're in new turf. And if we're able to go to the NCAA championship in baseball next year, it'd be the first time in the history of our program we've been there 3 years in a row. So we're in our infancy about stacking years after years, like Texas A&M, Mississippi State, Florida, LSU in baseball. But I've got confidence Scott has laid that foundation. And then what Tom's done from a basketball standpoint, I've been over there and watched practice because we can practice in the summer in a limited way. And these young men look a lot different than in the past. And I think our fans are so excited about what Tom's been able to do in a short amount of time. But, you know, gymnastics had a great year. We had pockets of really, really wonderful achievements this year and pockets that were so-so. So, you know, I'm to the point where I want to have 21 sports that are all challenging for national championships. It hadn't happened yet, but there's always a chance that that will happen.
You're very gracious to spend some time with us. Thank you so
Absolutely,
much.
Absolutely, my pleasure.